Hello student, today topic of discussion is puerperium. Puerperium is a 6-week period following childbirth during which the maternal system, especially the reproductive organ, more and less return to non-pregnant state. It is a period of adjustment after pregnancy and delivery when anatomical and physiological changes of pregnancy occur. During this period, woman recovers from stresses of pregnancy and delivery, and physiological adaptation which occur during pregnancy subside and facilitating the restoration of non-pregnant state. And the definition of puerperium. According to D.C. Datta, puerperium is defined as a period following childbirth during which the body tissue, especially the pelvic organ, revert back approximately to pre-pregnant state, both anatomically and physiologically. Duration of puerperium. Puerperium begins as soon as the placenta is expelled and lasts for approximately 6 weeks, when uterus becomes regressed almost to non-pregnant size. So now come to the stages of puerperium. The postpartum period has been divided into immediate puerperium up to the 24-hour, when acute and post-anesthetic and post-delivery complication may occur, and the early puerperium, which extend up to the first week of postpartum, and the remote puerperium up to the 6 weeks, during which genital involution occur. There is lots of changes occur in reproductive system, both anatomically and physiologically. So we will discuss here about anatomical changes. Involution of the uterus. What is involution? Involution is a return of uterus to non-pregnant state after childbirth. Involution process begins immediately after expulsion of placenta with contraction of uterine muscle. Immediately following childbirth, the uterus becomes firm and retract with alternate hardening and softening of the uterus. The fundus lies about 13.5 cm above the pubic symphysis and weight is 1000 gram. During the first 24 hours, the level of the uterus remains constant. After that, the fundus descends about 1 to 1.25 centimeter every day, so that by the end of second week, the uterus becomes a pelvic organ, and by the end of 6 week, the uterus becomes almost the normal in size. About the weight of the uterus, the weight changes as 1000 gram immediately after birth, excluding the fetus, placenta, membrane and amniotic fluid, 500 gram 1 week after birth, and 300 gram 2 week after birth, 50 gram 6 week after birth. The endometrial lining rapidly regenerate, which is completed by 16th day, except the placental side, which undergo a series of changes in the postpartum period. And come to the subinvolution. Subinvolution is the failure of uterus to return to a non-pregnant state. The common causes of subinvolution are retained placenta and placental beads and infection. Involution of the lower uterine segment. Immediately following delivery, the lower segment becomes thin, flabby, collapsed structure. It takes a few weeks to revert back to normal shape and size of the isthmus. Involution of the cervix. It is soft immediately after birth. The cervix up to the lower uterine segment remains edematous, thin for several days after birth. The cervical os, which is dilated to 10 cm during labor, closes gradually. it may still possible to introduce two finger into cervical canal for the first 4 to 6 postpartum day. The external os never regain its pre-pregnancy appearance. So there is a characteristic transverse slit occur. Cervix return to its normal state at 4 weeks after birth. Now we will look for physiological consideration. The physiological process of involution is most marked in the body of the uterus. Changes occur in the following component as muscle, blood vessel and endometrium. Changing in the uterine muscle. There is a marked hypertrophy and hyperplasia of muscle fiber during pregnancy, and individual muscle fiber enlarges to extent of 10 times and 5 times of breadth. During puerperium, the number of muscle fiber is not decreased, but this is substantial reduction of the myometrial cell size. There is a withdrawal of the steroid hormone, that is estrogen and progesterone, may lead to increase in activity of uterine collagenase and release of proteolytic enzyme, which helps in involution. What about the blood vessels? The arteries are constricted by contraction of its wall and thickening of intima, followed by thrombosis. During the first week, the arteries undergo thrombosis, hyalinization, and fibrinized end arthritis. The veins are obliterated by thrombosis, hyalinization, and endophlebitis. New blood vessels grow inside the thrombi. And comes to the endometrium, involution of the endometrium. Following delivery, the major part of decidua is cast off with expulsion of placenta and membranes more at the placental side. Decidua is the endometrium of pregnant uterus which sets after birth. The two layer, the zona compacta and zona spongiosa, are also set. The zona basalis remains intact and is the source of the new endometrium. Degeneration starts by the 7th day, it is completed by 10th day and restored by the 16th day. Except the placental time, except the placental site, it takes 6 weeks. Regeneration of the epithelium of the uterine gland, mouth and interglandular cell. Involution of the other pelvic structure as vagina. The distensible vagina, noticed soon after birth, takes a long time, that is 4 to 8 weeks. It regains its tone but never to virginal state. The mucosa remains delicate for the first few weeks and submucosal venous congestion persists even longer. It is the reason to withhold surgery on puerperal vagina. Rugosity partially reappear at 3rd week but never to the same degree as in pre-pregnant state. The introitus remains permanently larger than the virginal state. The hymen is lacerated and represented by nodular tag called carunculi myrtiformis. An involution of broad ligament and round ligament. It requires considerable time to recover from the stretching and laxation after the parturition. And involution of pelvic floor and pelvic fossa. It takes a long time to involute from a stretching effect during parturition. And come to the lochia. What is lochia? Lochia is the vaginal discharge that occurs after birth. Lochia is a discharge originate from the uterine body, cervix and vagina. For the first 2 hours after birth, the amount of lochia should be about that of the heavy menstrual period. After that time, the lochial flow should steadily decrease. Its odor and reaction. It has got a peculiar fishy smell. Its reaction is alkaline, leading to become acidic towards the end. Lochia color. Color of the lochia depending upon the variation of, and it is named as lochia rubra, red color. It persists for 1 to 4 days. It consists of blood, shreds of fetal membrane, and decidual and varnix caseosa, lanugo, and meconium. Lochia serosa, yellowish or pink or pale brownish in color. It persists for 5 to 9 days. It consists of old blood, loss of RBC, less of RBC, but more of leukocyte, and wound exudate, mucus from cervix, and microorganism, that is anaerobic streptococci and staphylococci. When general condition of body becomes low, that organism flare up and causes pelvic inflammatory disease or puerperal sepsis. Lochia serosa, which is pale white in color, it persists for 10 to 15 days. It contains plenty of residual cell, leukocyte, mucus, colistrin crystal, fatty and granular epithelial cell, and microorganism. And come to the amount and its normal duration. The average amount of discharge for the 5 to 6 days is estimated to be 250 ml. The normal duration may extend up to 3 weeks. Lochia rubra may persist for longer, especially in women with twin pregnancy, and it is scanty in premature labor. It can be more when women get up from bed in the later period, as in cesarean section. Clinical importance of lochia. The character of lochial discharge gives a useful information. The bulbar pad are to be inspected daily to get information about odor, amount, color, and duration. If it is offensive, it indicates that retained bits of placenta and cotton piece inside the vagina should be kept in mind, which is sometimes missed because of in management of traumatic PPH, vaginal pack is given or forget to remove it. Amount. A scanty or absent signify infection. Lochia metra, if it is excessive, it also indicate infection. Color. Persistence of lochia rubra beyond normal limit signify subinvolution or retained bits of conceptus. And duration. Duration of the lochia alba beyond 3 weeks suggests local genital lesion. And now we look for general physiological changes as pulse. After initial tachycardia associated with labor and delivery, bradycardia often develop in early puerperium. And temperature. A woman may show a slight increase in temperature during the first 24 hours after birth. Occasionally, when a woman's breast fills with milk on the third or fourth postpartum day, her temperature rises for a period of hour because of the increased vascular activity involved. It could be a genitourinary tract infection that should be excluded if there is rise of temperature persist. And what about the urinary tract? The bladder wall becomes edematous and hyperemic and often show evidence of submucous extravasation of blood. Because of relative insensitivity to the raised intravesical pressure due to trauma sustained to the nerve plexus during delivery, the bladder may be over-distended, without any desire to pass urine. Dilated ureter and renal pelvis return to normal size within 8 weeks. And effect on gastrointestinal tract. There is increased thirst in early puerperium is due to loss of fluid during labor or loss of blood in lochia and diuresis and perspiration after delivery. Constipation is the common problem of the following region. It is because of delayed gastrointestinal motility, because of mild ileus following delivery, and perineal discomfort due to episiotomy wound. And about the weight. In addition to weight loss, about 5 to 6 kg as a consequence of expulsion of fetus, placenta, liquor and blood loss, further loss of about 2 kg caused by diuresis and fluid loss. Net fluid loss of at least 2 liters during first week. Additional 1.5 liter during the next 5 weeks. The amount depends on amount retained during pregnancy and dehydration during labor and blood loss during delivery. And what about the blood values? Diuresis evident between 2nd to 5th day after birth, as well as blood loss at the birth. Aim to reduce the added volume accumulated during pregnancy. Rapid reduction occurs, so the blood volume returns to its normal pre-pregnancy level by 2nd week after birth. Cardiac output rises soon after delivery to about 60% above the pre-labor value, but gradually returns to normal within 1 week. And about the RBC volume and hematocrit. It returns to normal by the end of first week after the hydramnia disappear. Leukocytosis is to the extent of 25,000 per cubic millimeter occurs following delivery, probably in response to stress of labor. Platelet count decreases as soon after the separation of placenta, but secondary elevation occur with increase in platelet adhesiveness between 4 to 10 days. The fibrinogen level remains high up to the second week of puerperium, resulting in persistent high level of fibrinogen in puerperium as during pregnancy. A hypercoagulable state persists for 48 hours postpartum and fibrinolytic activity is enhanced in first 4 days, so it is beneficial for the woman. And we come to the menstruation and ovulation. The onset of first menstrual period after delivery depends upon the lactation. Anovulation and amenorrhea is due to elevated level of serum prolactin associated with suckling. If the woman does not breastfeed her baby, the menstruation returns by the 6th week following delivery in about 40% and by 12th week in 80% of cases. In non-lactating mother, ovulation may occur as early as 4 weeks and in lactating mother about 10 weeks after delivery. A woman who is exclusive breastfeeding, the contraceptive protection is about 98% up to the 6-month postpartum. Thus, lactation provides a natural method of contraception. Non-lactating mother should use contraceptive measure after 3 weeks and lactating mother after 3 months of delivery. So, now we will discuss on lactation. First 2 days following delivery, no further anatomical changes in the breast occur. The secretion from the breast called colostrum, which starts during pregnancy, becomes more abundant during this period. Composition of colostrum. It is a deep yellow serous fluid alkaline reaction. It has got a higher specific gravity, high protein, vitamin A, sodium and chloride content, but has got lower carbohydrate, fat and potassium than the breast milk. It contains antibody, IgA, macrophages, lymphocyte, lactoferrin and other enzyme. So there is a comparative study of colostrum versus breast milk. Advantages of colostrum: the antibody IgA, IgG, IgM and hormonal factor like lactoferrin provides immunological defense to the newborn. It has laxative action on because of the large fat globules. Now we will discuss on physiology of lactation. Although lactation starts following delivery, preparation of lactation occurs early in the pregnancy. So there are four phases. First is preparation of the breast, that is called mammogenesis. Second phase, synthesis and secretion from the breast, is called lactogenesis. And third phase, ejection of milk, that is called lactokinesis. And fourth phase is called maintenance of lactation, that is lactopoiesis. Mammogenesis. Pregnancy is associated with remarkable growth of both the ductal and lobulo-alveolar system. An intact nerve supply is not essential for growth of mammary gland during pregnancy. Milk secretion actually starts on third or fourth postpartum day. Around this time, the breast becomes engorged, dense, tender, and feel warm. When the progesterone and estrogen are withdrawn following delivery, prolactin begins its milk secretory activity in previously fully developed mammary gland. Galactokinesis. Discharge of milk from mammary gland depend not only the suction exerted by the baby during suckling, but also on the contractile mechanism which expresses the milk from the alveoli into the duct. Oxytocin is the major galactokinetic hormone that causes contraction of myoepithelial cell. This is the chart of physiology of lactation. Galactopoiesis. Prolactin appears to be the single most important galactopoietic hormone. Continuous suckling is essential for removal of milk from gland into release. Secretion is the continuous process unless suppressed by congestion or emotional disturbance. Come to the on milk production. A healthy mother will produce about 500 to 800 ml of milk per day with about 500 kilocalorie per day. This requires 600 kilocalorie per day for the mother, which must be made up from mother's diet or from her body store. Stimulation of lactation. Mother is motivated about the benefits of breastfeeding since early in the pregnancy for increased lactation. No prelacteal feed like honey or water is given to the baby. Following delivery, important steps are to be taken are as to put the baby to the breast at 2 to 3 hours interval from the first day. Plenty of fluid to drink is given to mother to avoid breast engorgement, and early and exclusive breastfeeding in correct position are encouraged as soon as 30 minutes to 1 hour after expulsion of the placenta. In spite of this, lactation failure occur. Ductal and alveolar distension due to failure of milk transfer, that is suckling, is cause of lactation failure. Milk pressure reduces the rate of production and hence periodic breastfeeding is necessary. So, due to infrequent suckling or due to endogenous suppression of prolactin by some drugs as ergot preparation, pyridoxine, diuretics, or sometimes it is due to retained placental beads, these all causes lactation failure. Only solution is baby is to given unrestricted feeding at short interval, that is 2 to 3 hours. Drugs to improve milk production. There are so many drugs which improve the milk production. These drugs are metoclopramide 10 mg thrice daily, increases milk volume of 60 to 100% by increasing the prolactin level. And sulpride, dopamine antagonist, has also been found effective. Intranasal oxytocin contracts myoepithelial cell and causes milk letdown reflex. Lactation suppression. Sometimes it may be needed for a woman who cannot breastfeed for personal and medical reason. Suppression of lactation is necessary if the baby is born dead or dies in the neonatal period, or if breastfeeding is contraindicated. So there are so many methods how to suppress lactation. One of them is to stop breastfeeding to avoid pumping or milk expression, to wear brassiere, and to relieve pain by the ice pack or aspirin. A tight compression bandage is applied for 2 to 3 days, and bromocriptine is given 2.5 to 1 tab daily for 10 to 15 days. This is a dopamine agonistic that inhibits prolactin, but side effects are more. It causes hypotension, rebound breast engorgement, secretion, myocardial infarction, and puerperal stroke. Thank you. आप सुना तो भाई कुछ कुछ तो गड़बड़ हुआ।